Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O Son of the Heavenly Father, it was pleasing in your eyes to become the Son of the Virgin Mary, and so the Archangel Gabriel came to announce the good tidings, bringing the peace of the Father to the one who is blessed among all women. Prepare us to celebrate your glorious birth with joy and gladness, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children. Let us raise glory, honor, and praise to the Father who sent Gabriel to Nazareth as a messenger, and to the Son who dwelt in the Virgin Mary as the good tidings, and to the Spirit who sanctified her and accomplished this wondrous mystery. To the good one be glory and honor on this feast and all the days of our lives and forever. Glory to you, O exalted one, for you chose to live among us. You are the power who dwelt in the pure Virgin Mary, and you appeared from her as God incarnate. Today we cry out proclaiming, Blessed are you, O Mary, because the Son of God has chosen you as his mother. Blessed are you, O Mary, because of you Adam has been freed. Blessed are you, O Mary, because you are the glory of the nations and the pride of all generations. Now, O Word of God, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense, and in your mercy to pardon our faults, and to give us the gifts of your Spirit. Grant security to your flock and peace to your monasteries and convents, piety to priests and purity to deacons, dignity to the elderly and generosity to parents, restraint to the youth and a good education to children. Sanctify the monks and nuns and spread truth and charity throughout the world. Grant rest to the departed in your eternal kingdom, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father and to your Holy Spirit forever.
Amen.
the earth will sing praise of age to age.
Virgin Mary, you are the cloud who has dropped down dew upon the world, filling it with the sweet fragrance of Christ. On this feast of your Annunciation, implore your only Son with us to accept our incense and to fill us with his heavenly graces, so that we may thank him, his Father, and his Holy Spirit forever.
Amen.
Kadi shantalo kodi shant,
hayantalo kodi shant.
Sent to earth this day to announce to the Virgin, you shall bear the one who saves.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Galatians.
Baruch Moroch. Glory to the Lord of Paul and the Apostles. May the mercy of God descend upon the reader, the listeners, and upon this parish, and to children forever.
In human terms, I say that no one can annul or amend even a human will once ratified. Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his seed. It does not say, and to seed, as referring to many, but as referring to one. And to your descendant, and to your seed, who is Christ. This is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterward, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God, so as to cancel the promise. For if the inheritance comes from the law, it is no longer from a promise. But God bestowed it on Abraham through a promise. Why then the law? It was added for transgressions, until the seed came to whom the promise had been made. It was promulgated by angels at the hand of a mediator. Now there is no mediator when only one party is involved, and God is one. Is the law then opposed to the promises of God? Of course not. For if a law had been given that could bring life, then righteousness would in reality come from the law. But Scripture confined all things under the power of sin, that through faith in Jesus Christ, the promise might be given to those who believe. Praise be to God always.
For the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Shlomo Elokeinu Chunam. From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Saint Luke, who proclaimed life unto the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls. The evangelist Luke writes, "In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man named Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And coming unto her, he said, Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you. But she was greatly troubled at what had been said, and she pondered what sort of greeting this might be. Then the angel said to her, Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you shall conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. He will be great, and shall be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of David his father, and he shall rule over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. And Mary said to the angel, How shall this be, as I do not know man? And the angel said to her in reply, The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And therefore the child to be born shall be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. And this is now the sixth month for her who had been called barren. For nothing shall be impossible for God. And Mary said, Behold the handmaid of the Lord. May it be done to me according to your word. And then the angel departed from her. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Our Lord and
to seed as to one, and not as seeds as to many. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. So we've been discussing this word, seed, because in the Hebrew and in English, it has both a plural and a singular meaning. Now, of course, oftentimes in the translations you may have, it'll say progeny or descendants or whatever, and that's obviously the sense. But the word itself is seed. The seed is the descendants of the men, the fathers. And the reason why St. Paul is then playing, the same way in English we can say the same thing. When you plant a seed, or you plant seed in your garden, or you seed a field, no one's thinking about walking out with a single grain and putting it in the dirt. You have a bunch of seeds. And so St. Paul is playing on this idea. It's like our word in English, sheep. Plural and singular, the same word. And he's saying, but the terminology which is in the Hebrew, that the promise is made to the seed of Abraham, he says, it's not seed in the sense of just simply the natural descendants of Abraham. It's singular. And that's the Christ. And the Christ is the fulfillment of this promise. There is an unbelievable amount of things to unpack over these last 2 weeks of promise and law and God's goodness and giving. And we begin by talking about even your last will and testament. I mean, you may have cantankerous nieces and nephews who will contest it, but normally everyone just accepts that this is what you want and they just put it into effect. So St. Paul says, so even among human beings, we don't contest that designation, which is the promise. This is what God wants and God is to have accomplished. And so when we talk about seed, it's also an important word because, of course, you have the famous prophecy in Genesis where God sets enmity between the woman and the serpent, between her seed and his seed. Now, this is important because, of course, nowhere in the scriptures do we speak about the seed of a woman. And yet in this instance, in Genesis, in the very beginning of Revelation that we have recorded for us chronologically, we have the seed of the woman. And so the fathers of the church interpret the seed of the woman as to show precisely that the woman is not Eve, but the woman is the Blessed Virgin Mary, the new Eve, of which we speak a lot in the bulletin this week. And it shows her virgin maternity, because that term seed is not used for anyone else ever in the scriptures, except for this one woman in this instance in the combat with the devil. So it's very impressive. So the words do mean things. We can say it's understanding our descendants, but it's much more profound than that. And so don't tamper with the words. They may be confusing in the ancient Greek and ancient Hebrew and Aramaic, but that's okay. That's what exegesis is for. Don't change the text. And so we've been having this discussion. But it's the thing to bring up because we've been discussing, like the word promise. What does promise mean? So in our English, when we use the word promise, it's actually a Latin word. And so pro, P-R-O in Latin, means in front of something or on behalf of something. And the verb is actually me today, to send. But the past participle is missum, having been sent. And so pro missum is literally the thing which has been sent before or on behalf of. That's what a promise is. And so it's a perfect terminology for what St. Paul is trying to say, that God intervenes in the life of Abraham. And as we mentioned last week, and clearly these readings from Romans last week and Galatians this week, the church wants us to really be spending these 2 weeks considering the law, the promises, and what is faith. Now, faith is one of those mysterious things that a lot of words we talk about, but to understand what it actually means and why does it heal, why does it justify, not because it makes us better in the sense, but it makes us better in the sense that we're healed. And so promise, law, and all these things. And of course, today in Galatians, St. Paul is pointing out that in the Galatians, he talks about his conversion again. It's recounted a couple times in the Acts of the Apostles and again in the letter to the Galatians, because it means so much that God intervenes. God, in this sense, sends to him outside of Damascus this light that blinds him and knocks him off his horse. So the question becomes, what do you do when that happens in your life? This is the question of faith. God is always intervening in our life. Now, St. Paul is using the paradigm historically of Abraham. And Abraham is a very important figure to consider during this season of announcements. So your homework assignment for this week is to read Genesis 12 through 25. This is the story of Abraham. And it's the first story that we have because the first 11 chapters of Genesis are about the story of God's creation of the world. We considered this yesterday, on Saturday, and a bit yesterday evening for the first of the three masses of Sunday. And then we will talk about the exchange and the question of the seed fulfillment aspect at 11, because there's too much here. But here is just to consider this Abraham question. So the first 11 chapters of Genesis are about God's creation, his giving, his goodness. Promise in that sense is God's creation. He makes existence. He gives us a fruitful earth. You had that, I don't know if you noticed the newspaper articles recently, because we just topped 8 billion people on the planet, which is pretty amazing considering how many billions have popped up in our lifetime. And so, but the articles were going on because, of course, Europe and North America are like, yes, and that's why we have to hand out condoms and make those Africans behave and not have babies. And all those people in the Middle East, all those Muslims always having eight, seven, nine children. No. The world's going to die. But now, of course, we're into all the racial questions. And so you can't say that because then it says, well, it's racism. All right, so then you have people who now honestly say, well, actually, the earth is very fruitful. And it's not the problem of fecundity of food, it's how we distribute the food and how we distribute the wealth of the planet. So even at 8 billion people, there is a recognition. Now, unfortunately, it has to be some other neurotic cultural aspect on racial questions that have to make us honest on the fertility, because in the 70s, they all told you we were going to die, right? This is why everyone started contracepting in the 70s. And now, of course, we don't have any children, so this is a problem. So you have all these questions of, well, what is the distribution of the earth? And that fecundity of the earth that they recognize, of course, is real. And we've mentioned this a few months ago. Anyone who's ever planted a garden knows that if you don't really pay attention to it, it just takes over. You know, the forest and the edge of your property, you need to maintain. Otherwise, it's just going to take over the rest of your house. And so nature is very fecund with life. God has made it very rich and very productive. That is his first promise. That is his gift. Be fruitful and multiply. And the first 11 chapters of Genesis are on that. God creates the world. God creates nature. He places man in creation to take care of that fruitfulness and to return it adorned as this reciprocation, if you like, this friendship between God and man. And he creates the land, and he creates the produce, and he creates the weather and the seasons, and he gives it to Adam and Eve. He gives it to mankind. Not to own and to say, this is mine, get out of my yard, but in order to share with everyone else, because it's one family. And that's what the first 11 chapters of Genesis are about. It's the creation of one human race, one family, one set of parents, Adam and Eve. Everyone's related. That's why the neurosis over race is so absurd in the Catholic understanding. Who cares what color your eyes are? Who cares the size or the color of your skin? This is not, you are all the children of Adam. Period. We're all related. And we know this even by the science of genetics, that everyone goes back to one male and one female. Now, of course, this freaks out people who want evolution, that at some point we were monkeys, but you can show it here. So now they have to say, well, it just means that the only human beings on the earth now happen to be from those two people. All right, so who wiped out all the other millions? It's insane how we do these tap dancing in our heads when nature is so obvious that it is the hand of God everywhere in these things. So anyways, I digress, as usual. So the first 11 chapters of Genesis are about the oneness of the family of men, of human beings. And that's why chapter 11 is what? The Tower of Babel. It's when they decide that this is not going to be shared. We're going to show how awesomely incredible we are, and we're going to build this massive city, and we're going to make ourselves like God, and we're going to build this tower. It's all the exaltation of the human race and the idea of possessiveness. It's mine, mine, mine. You see it in the two-year-olds. Mine, slap. Or slap mine, and you take it. This is chapter 11 in Genesis, and God says, this is not what was created. And if you're going to use your intelligence and your free will to destroy and possess this in what is paganism, it's paganism. That's why he scatters the people across the earth. Make you smaller groups. Live like the family you are meant to be then, because you're obviously ruining that image. That is chapter 11, the division of the human race. Because of its paganism and its selfishness and its possessiveness and its naturalism. And so chapter 12, that you will begin to read, is God then intervening in the life of a man. So, Abraham is the son of Eber. This is where we get the word Hebrew. And Eber is the son of Shem from the flood. And Shem is the son of Noah, which is basically a new creation of the human race, because God's like, okay, clean the slate, erase the board, we start again. And so Abram winds up being called in what's now southern Iraq, Mesopotamia. And he calls him out of the pagan family. Leave behind these idols. So we're not told Abraham doesn't do anything any more than St. Paul does anything going on his horse to Damascus. He's going actually to arrest people because they're Christian. So he's not disposed to receive a promise, the intervention, the sending forth of God into their lives. So promise is, in the paradigm of Abraham, a very distinct historical moment about 4,000 years ago. But God is always intervening in our lives, much to the upset of our own plans. But that's okay. God's plans are always better, even if we don't like them. And when we learn that, peace will radiate in our lives. The more that we just try to make it work the way we want, that's the Tower of Babel. That is possessiveness. It's my life. I'll do what I want with it. It's like, well, it's not really your life. It was given to you also. And so Abraham is in this promise first told, leave your family and the idols of your family. They are pagans. They may be generations after Noah, but they've already gone back to paganism. Remember, paganism is about control and power. Doesn't matter what you worship, it's control and power. It may be money, it may be Jupiter, it may be Apollo. Doesn't matter. Maybe Baal. You give it a name, but whatever in your life is that pursuit of power and manipulation, control, that will always degenerate into paganism. So, now that I've spent too much time on this, we're going to go three basic promises that are made in Abraham's life. And what's important to understand is he makes three promises, three things that intervene during this man's life. He lives to be over 100. And during this time, so many of these promises on a human level make absolutely no sense. None whatsoever. And so we talked about that last week. But what's interesting to notice if you read these chapters is there is a promise made, but there is in the later chapters kind of like an upgrade to the promise, which is interesting. More details are given. But in the middle of it, Abraham has done something, reacting to the promise. And then God responds and makes it more rich. So you go from promise, which is God just intervening in Abraham's life. He goes from southern Mesopotamia. He goes to the north where all the wars are going on in Mosul and that area. That is the area he goes to, the area of Edessa, Turkey, of PKK, and all the fights between the Turks and the Kurds and all of this. This is the area where Abraham went
4,000 years ago. And when his father passed away, he winds up coming down through the area of Lebanon in Syria and into the area of what's now Israel and actually all the way down to Egypt and back up to Israel, being promised this land and never seeing any of it and dying a stranger in the land that he had been told will be yours. That we considered last week. So God gives three interventions. All right. So he promises to make Abraham a great nation. All right, this man who wanders around with his old father and his wife is sterile and no children. You're going to be a great nation. That's in chapter 12, right in the beginning. Then you have, he says, the second intervention is he says, I will give you a great name. All these three are in chapter 12. I will make a great name for you. You will have renown. Everyone will know you. Now again, he's wandering around with just a wife, no children, nobody knows me. And then the third thing he says is that in your seed, the nation shall be blessed. So these are the three fundamental promises that come in. This is why between Romans last week and Galatians this week, sometimes it's in the plural, sometimes it's in the singular, promise or promises. So these are the three events that come in. Now, I want to talk about what they become is covenant. They go from being promised, God just initiates. I gave you goodness, I gave you life. It's like our personal creation. None of us had a say in it. We didn't have a say to exist. We didn't have a say to the family we were born into, the conditions we were born into. God just gives this life. That's why when someone says, it's my life, I can do with it what I want, it's not really true. Philosophically, it's not true. Life is given to us. And so, but once it's given to us, God expects an intelligent and loving return. I made you intelligent and the ability to love. You're supposed to react to what is good. Not grab it and make it your own as if it was your origin that produced it. And so what happens here is covenant, the word covenant, we use this a lot in religion. But the word covenant, again, is a Latin word. The base of it is venire, which means to come. Cum in the beginning was C-O-N now, but it's originally C-U-M, cum. Cum venire then literally means to come together. God is in his goodness overflowing, just giving goodness in our lives. What do we do? The pagan culture says, no, 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 no. You have to live in terror and fear and make sure you have life insurance because when you kick the bucket, your spouse and all your children are going to wither up and die if you don't have life insurance. This is a horrible way to live. This is the way pagans live. Terror, sheer terror. There's not enough food. There's not enough this. There's not enough that. Of course, we have to intelligently use creation. That is normal. Not exploit it, not destroy it. But it is rich by God's gift. And when we understand that, we respond. And we come together with God and it becomes covenant. This is why St. Paul says he does this with the people of Israel. But it's over 400 years later. The promises of the blessings to the nations are given to Abraham. And therefore, we are the fulfillment that comes with the coming of the Messiah. Again, it's more complex. I just want to talk about the promise and the covenants today. So in this promise that I will make you a great nation, that is linked to the covenant. I will give you this specific land. But in between that promise of a great nation and this specific land, you have the episode of Melchizedek. You have the episode that takes place of the war around the cities of Lot's residence around what is now the Dead Sea. At the time, it was a valley of trees and five different towns, not just Sodom and Gomorrah. There were five cities that were destroyed in this area. But you have Melchizedek, and everything you know about Melchizedek, that intervenes in chapter 14. So you have chapter 12 with the promise, chapter 14 with the wars, and chapter 15 of this specific land, that covenant is expanded in chapter 15. The promise that is made then, I will give you a great name. In chapter 17 is when he changes the name of Abram to Abraham You will become the father of nations, and kings will come from you. And that in between what takes place is the response of Abraham, which becomes circumcision. This is why St. Paul, throughout his letters, goes on and on. I have people who have asked me over the years, why are we always talking about circumcision? It's a bit embarrassing. And it's like, because this is the moment that St. Paul, so God says, you have a covenant in your flesh. It is a physical reminder. Be the equivalent of something like a tattoo, something that is physically, permanently now part of you in your response. But it's only after the second promise. And it's after promise is already being initiated, which is why St. Paul says the circumcision doesn't matter. What matters is the response to the problem, to the promise. And so the circumcision comes in, and then he says, you are now from Abraham, you are now Abraham, you are now the father of nations, and kings will come forth from you. So it becomes covenant. And so now the circumcision becomes an expression of a response to God's promises, not to the law of Moses. Moses isn't going to be born for another 500 years. And finally, the third promise, in your seed, your descendants, all the nations will be blessed. And remember, this promise is given at the very beginning of this man's life. And he lives for decades, year after year, decade after decade, sterile. They have no children. Am I being mocked? What are you doing to me? That would be a natural reaction. You tell me these things and you don't show me anything. That would be our human reaction to him. But Abraham believes this because it's God who speaks. And so he continues on, and of course, then you have the famous episode in Genesis 22 towards the end of this section. And in 21 and 22, the birth of Isaac. Ishmael is a whole other story that we've talked about before. Which is his son, and it's legitimate. There's no problem with Ishmael, but he's not a child of the promise. He's a child of human wits. Marrying one of the slave girls and having another family and having Ishmael is no problem. And though he is the father of the Arab peoples, these things continue to this day. But then, of course, the key is the binding of Isaac. The binding of Isaac, that you will sacrifice the very child of the promise, after going on for decades, sterile, with all these promises. And then we come and we tell you, you will have a child. Your wife doesn't believe it. You think it's hilarious, but you believe. And Isaac is born the next year. And then God says after that, at about the age of 12, Isaac was, now I want you to offer him to me. This becomes the Christian, the carrying of the wood, being offered by your father, being crucified in Jerusalem. All of these things are images of the Christ. That's why the seed to whom is not actually Isaac. The seed is Jesus of Nazareth. These are so extraordinarily beautiful. And that as the good rabbi that St. Paul was, he's giving in the Mishnah this interpretation of the book of Genesis to say, you are not shackled to the law of Moses. It only comes in centuries after the reality. And we told you, what is the key behind the binding of Isaac? It's not some father who loses his mind and decides to kill his son. It is this man after decades who knows that this is the God of life. This is the good one. And if he is asking me to offer and sacrifice this child, it's because he will raise him from the dead, because all the nations of the earth are going to be blessed. And I believe this. This is why last week, if you remember, there was that phrase, hoping against hope. Everything in this story, on a human level, makes no sense. This is the important part. And yet Abraham continues to believe because this is the promise of God. And God is the good one. And in verse 20, when he finishes with this whole thing, when they arrive at Moriah, So Moriah is where the Dome of the Rock is in Jerusalem. When you see the golden dome, that is the rock, that why it's called the Dome of the Rock. The rock is the place that by tradition where Abraham took Isaac to sacrifice him. This is why everyone fights over, the Christians less so, because for us it's more historical, the paradigm of faith. But between the Jews and the Arabs, they want this rock because this is the story. Of course, for them it's not Isaac, for the Muslims it's Ishmael, but that's a whole nother sermon. So in this idea of the son who carries the wood up the hill to be offered in sacrifice by his father, all of this is actually, he is the seed, but the seed is only, this is a type in Isaac. And that's why it's not called the slaying of Isaac or the sacrifice, it is the binding of Isaac. But there's a very beautiful phrase in this same chapter that when they arrive on Mount Moriah, you don't usually catch this in the text, which is why I want to point it out to you. When they arrive there, there are servants with Abraham in all of this like dramatically emotional upheaval going on. But faith takes supreme power over those emotions, which is why Abraham does this. And when they arrive, Isaac asks him, "Father, what are we going to offer in sacrifice? Because there's no animal. We're not bringing an animal with us. So what are we actually offering to God?" And Abraham says to his son, "God will provide." This becomes the beginning of the word Yireh. God, he will provide with Shalem, Salem. This becomes the origin of Jerusalem, Yireh Salem. This becomes, he will provide Shalom. Peace. This idea is extraordinary. And he doesn't say anything to Isaac except God will provide. That is the act of faith. And of course, before the two of them leave to go to the rock, Abraham says to his servants, "We will worship, we will worship, and then we will return. We will return to you." It's a small phrase, but he tells his servants, he's not lying, but he has this faith of the God of life, that both of us are going to come back, even if it requires my son to be raised from the dead. So Isaac becomes this symbol, becomes this type of the reality of Christ. And this is absolutely extraordinary. So I highly encourage you, because clearly what the church wants us to do is to contemplate what faith is. And this is why now you understand better when I mentioned last week between Mary and Zechariah, who say almost exactly the same words to the angel. In fact, Mary gives a reason why this shouldn't work. "I don't know man. How am I going to have a child?" Zechariah doesn't even give an excuse of why his disbelief is actually logical. But between the two of them, there is one who understands that if this is what is said, that the promises to Abraham, the fulfillment of these things, which is why Zechariah is made mute, but the Blessed Virgin Mary is transformed. "Be it done unto me according to your word, because I am the handmaid of God. And I follow your word," and that transmission of faith and that transformation changes promises of God. With the catechism book that's on your desk or on a shelf someplace becomes a living reality, because now it's not just a book about the teaching of the Catholic Church. It is my faith. It is my transmission that I receive over 2,000 years. That transforms me, and it's no longer a book and a text, but it becomes covenant in my personal life, because I have come together with God who has promised me life, because he is the God who gives life to the dead, and he is the living one. He is, as we say in our beautiful Syriac tradition, he is simply the good one. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
believe in one God,
the Father of all creation, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us sin and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and he seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins,
and we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Itelot madem heda loho, valvot aloho dem chale tayut, vainem sugo taivu taho keu lalvai toch vesku dem hayek lo, od goda shochem.
Your children have brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your imperishable kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, the Chosen One, our Holy Father, Saint Marin, Saint Jude, and Saint Gregory of Decapolis. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
Continue with the anaphora of St. John Chrysostom on page 876. 876. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord God and Father, holy and glorious is your name. You deliver those who love you from all that is contrary to your holy will. May we who have remained in your divine love be made worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with a holy kiss. May we always speak words of peace, think of peace, and work for peace. Through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, we raise glory to you and to your living Holy Spirit, now and forever. Peace to you, O holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O server of the Holy Spirit. Let us give the greeting of peace to our neighbor with love and faith that are pleasing to God. Creation, you are peace, reconciling those who are enemies. You are forgiveness to those who sin, and you are comfort to those who are sorrowful. Open the door of your mercy to our petitions, and in the abundance of your grace, accept our prayers. Make us children and heirs of your kingdom through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, and through your Holy Spirit, now and forever. You are adored by all. Angels bless you, humanity exalts you, and all creation glorifies you. Look upon your children who call out to you. With purity and holiness, may we offer you an acceptable sacrifice, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. The Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them
give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship him with humility. Truly it is right and just to thank, adore, glorify, and bless the majesty of the one consubstantial Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, a majesty that does not need our glory or become greater with our thanks. O Lord, those who sing your praises are countless, and they cry out with angelic voices and sweet melodies proclaiming. Glory to you, O God, the Heavenly Father, for you have exalted our beautiful nature. In your mercy, you sent your only Son into the world for our salvation. He dawned from the Holy Virgin like a ray of light from a bright cloud. He took the form of a slave, but truly he is the Son of your Majesty, who willingly became man to make us divine. He was born of a woman's womb, and he might be born again from the spiritual womb. He became our brother, so that through his grace we may become your children and heirs. He took us from being slaves and made us your children. He promised us a share of the reward that allows us to call you Abba. He cleansed us from our sins with his precious blood that he poured out for us, for he is your only Son. Kurie eleison, vabiamo haudactum hashodi lema bedhaye. And Sabe Lachma Mina Kori Shanto Ubarachu Kodesh Waksoya Bentalmita Koro Mara Sabahula Mehene Kulhu Hono Denita Fahro Dil Dachlo Faikun Wachlov Sagie Me tefeseu me tiheb, usoyon ha me wa ha yedon qaylam alamin. Amin. Ho kanna wal kosa dam zikho min hamro min mayo. Baruch Hu Kodesh Uya Ben Talmida Karo Mara Sabishtau Mehne Kulhu Hono Denita Demo Dila Diyati Ki Chadato Dachlo Faikun Wachlo Sagiyem Mete Sheru Mete Hev Husayon Chame wa Chayedan Chaylam Alamin. Amen. Do this in memory of me. Each time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you remember my death until I come again. Comprehend that you willingly emptied yourself of your divine glory. Who can explain your miraculous birth from a virgin? Who can repay you for your saving passion which you freely endured? Who can praise your plan of salvation for us? We can only ask of you, O lover of all people, that this sacrifice which we have offered be accepted on your altar in heaven, the dwelling place of your hidden divinity in the company of all the angels and saints. Through this sacrifice may we be worthy of the forgiveness of our sins. When you come to judge the living and the dead, do not pass judgment upon us nor deny us, saying, I do not know you. On that glorious and fearful day, do not separate us from you, for you nor cast us out of your paradise to a place of weeping and gnashing of teeth. Rather, because of your holy name, by which we have been called, look with mercy upon us. In your compassion, you have made us worthy of the gift of your forgiving body and blood. So make us worthy to be one with you in holiness, as you are one with your Father. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you implores your Father, saying, as we, your sinful children, receive your graces, we thank you for them and because of them.
We praise you and bless you.
To sanctify our power and your Holy Spirit, to sanctify the altar, to sanctify the offerings, to rest upon this bread and wine, that we become the one body and blood of your only Son.
Annin Morio,
Annin Morio. Annin Morio, Anite Moro, Chayo, Kodisho, Unachen, the Lainu, Ado Corbono, Ono.
A pledge of the life to come, a body that grants us the everlasting joys of heaven, a body that renews our souls and bodies, a body that purifies us of all sin for eternal life.
Amen.
And that the mixture in this chalice, the blood of Christ our God, be a blood that gives new life to those who receive it, a blood that guides us to the safe harbors and the dwellings of light. A blood that renews our souls and bodies, a blood that purifies us of all sin for eternal life.
Amen.
O Lord, in your great mercy, when this body and blood is mingled with our bodies and souls, grant that it may be for the pardon of faults, the forgiveness of sins, and for the everlasting joy and eternal life with all your saints.
Amen.
We offer you, Lord God, this pure and holy offering for your holy, Catholic, and apostolic church, which you have redeemed. Gather her children into unity, love, and faith, and guide them in peace and security. We offer it for the pure bishops of the true faith, Francis, the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Gregory John, our bishop, the venerable priests, the chaste deacons, the pure subdeacons, and all the orders of the church. Teach them the word of truth, so that they may spread it faithfully. With justice and holiness, may they care for the flock that you have entrusted to them. Give them the proper means to accomplish your will, and grant them a long life. We pray to you, O Lord.
For the poor and the dejected, for orphans and widows, for the sick and the distressed, and for those tempted by evil spirits, be the guardian and refuge of their lives.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember the holy fathers, prophets, apostles, preachers, evangelists, martyrs and confessors, especially the holy, glorious, and blessed ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint John the Baptist, the messenger and forerunner, who witnessed the betrothal of your holy church to your Son, glorious Saint Stephen, the archdeacon and first martyr, and all who pleased you and professed your name. We pray to you, O Lord.
The faithful departed who have gone to you from this altar and from every place throughout the world, grant them rest in your heavenly dwellings with all your saints, and in your mercy forgive our sins and theirs. Do not deprive us of your mercy, but keep us in the palm of your hand, lest we fall and go astray, so that we may walk on your paths, follow your ways, and do your will. Forgive us and our departed, and pardon all sins and transgressions, hidden and seen, committed with or without full knowledge. Make us worthy of a faithful Christian death that is pleasing to you, and join us to your righteous ones and to those who have done your will, that in us and in all things your blessed name may be glorified with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever.
Son, who is the radiance of your eternity, and he accomplished his plan of salvation for us, that we may come to you. May we call upon you with the prayer that he taught his holy disciples, the saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are thine. Yes, O merciful Lord, we ask for your compassion. By your grace, make us worthy that your glorious name may be made holy in us, that your kingdom come to assist us in our weakness, and that your will dwell within us. Deliver us from all difficult temptations. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Shlomo elukuruchunna. O Lord God, you are good and the lover of all people. Look upon those who bow their heads before your majesty and bless them with every spiritual blessing. Do not turn us away when we approach your divine and holy gifts, and let us not be guilty of unworthily receiving the body and blood of your only Son. Rather, make us worthy to share in your holy and life-giving mysteries with purity, so that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your good and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord,
for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory forever.
Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ are given to me for the forgiveness of our sins.
Yeah.
Again and again we thank you, O Lord, and we raise glory to you for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us. Lord Jesus, you have made us worthy to share in your holy body and in the cup of salvation. How can we repay you for these, your gifts and graces, and for your goodness? As you have called us to approach this life-giving banquet, make us worthy, so that your body may be mingled with our bodies and your blood with our souls, for the pardon of faults, the forgiveness of sins, and for eternal life. You are blessed and your kingdom is holy, and we raise glory to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Shlomo Elokurchunna.
Amen. O
God the Father, we bow before you and we entrust ourselves to your care. We ask you, imploring your mercy, to rest your right hand full of blessings upon us. Assist us, protect us, bless us, and sanctify us by the cross of your only Son. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Amen. I leave you.